Now let's see the longest remaining time first. So in longest remaining time first, or we can call it as preemptive longest job first scheduling. Okay, so both are same. Now here, if at time t we have longer job available, so we will preempt the already ongoing process and make the room for longer job. So see here, by this example it will get clear. Now at time 0, see here 1 2 3 5, so at time 0 we do not have any process available. So from 0 say 0 to 1, this is ideal, CPU is ideal. At time 1 we have a process available of burst time 2. If it was non preemptive, then we will schedule for total time, but here since it is preemptive, so we will schedule till the arrival of the next process. So we have scheduled it till 2 and P1 is scheduled. Now it is remaining for 1. Now if you see at time 2 we have longer job. This one is of 1, this one is of 4. Which one is longer? Obviously P2. So we will schedule it for till the arrival of next job. Now this will become 3. At time 3, this is also available, this is also available, this is also available. Which one is longest? Obviously this one is longest. So we will schedule it till the arrival of next process. So till 5 we will schedule it, and it will become 5 burst time. Now remaining time is 5. Now at time 5 all 4 are available, out of which this is highest. In shortest job, if we are available with shortest job here, then we will schedule for the time, whole time. But see here, the difference is when you decrease it, what will happen? It will become shorter and shorter. One time will occur when it will become the same size of the previous one, and now according to the priority of the process ID. So we, if the times are tie, then we give priority to the lower process ID. So we will schedule this one. So what will happen? Instead of scheduling it for whole 9, we will schedule it for till 5 only. Why? Because the second largest process is 5. Okay, so now let's see P4, and we have scheduled it for 4 times. So that is till 9. At 9, it will become of size 5. Now we have 1 3 5 5. These two processes are largest and have same burst time. Now which one is coming first? P3. So we will schedule P3, and only for 1 second. Why? Because when we schedule it for 1 second, it will become 4 and no longer it will be largest. Largest will be 5. So now we will schedule P4, which is still 11, till 1, because when you decrease it by 1, it will become equal to this one, and now it will no longer be largest, it will be a tie, and tie is broken by smallest ID first. So this will become 3, and now this is the largest, so P4. Now both are same, and you, if you see, now we have 1 3 3 3 time remaining. So 1 is this, 3 is this, 3 is this, and 3 is this. So see here, now we have 3 processes of same time, and we have a tie here. So tie is broken by smallest number first. So smallest number is P2. So we will schedule P2 for 1 time only. Why? Because when you schedule it for 1 time, now it will no longer be the largest. Now the tie is between this, and out of these two, which one is a smaller process ID? P3. So we will schedule P3 for 1 time. Why? Because when you schedule it for 1, it will no longer be the largest. Now largest is P4. So P4 is still 16. Now it will become 2. Again, like we did for 3, we will do for 2 also. Now at 2, the tie will be broken by the smallest ID first. So it will be scheduled. So P2 till 17, and now we will schedule this one for 1, which is P3 till 18. Then lastly this, and it will be P4 till 19, and now all are of size 1. So we will schedule from the process ID, which is the lowest, P1. So P1 till 20, and this will be over. Then P2, this will be till 21, it will be over. Then P3 till 22, and it will be over. And at last, P4 till 23, and it will be over. I know this is little complex. You have to take care of burst time at every timestamp. So please practice this question again and again. So at least try this question for 2-3 times, and it will be clear to you. Now, if you want to calculate the start time, completion time, turnaround time, waiting time, and remaining time, so we can calculate it like this. So let's say this is process ID. So we have four processes: P1, P2, P3, P4. So start time of P1, we will look from left hand side, is 1. Start time for P2 is 2, for P3 is 3, for P4 is 5. Completion time we will look from right hand side. So completion time of P1 is, so we are encountering P1 for the first time here. So it is completing at 20. For P2 it is here, so it is at 21. For P3 it is here, so it is at 22. And P4 at last is at 23. Now if you want to calculate turnaround time, so it is completion time minus arrival time. Now arrival time is 1, 2, 3, 5. So 20 minus 1 is 19, 21 minus 2 is 19, 23 minus 3 is 19, 23 minus 5 is 18. What is waiting time? Turnaround time minus burst time. So you know burst time is 2, 4, 7, 9. So 19 minus 2 is 17, 19 minus 4 is 15, 19 minus 7 is 12, 18 minus 9 is 9. And what is response time? Start time minus arrival time. And here arrival time is 1, 2, 3, 5. Start time is also 1, 2, 3, 5. So it will become 0, 0, 0, 0. And now if you want to calculate the average turnaround time, add them and divide by total number of processes, which is 4. Similarly, average waiting time. So add these values and divide by 4, and average response time is 0, because if you add 0 and divide by 4, it will become 0 only. What is CPU utilization? So pay attention here. We have started our timeline from 0 till 23. So total time is 23, whereas we have done useful work from 1 till 23. This cycle is wasted. Okay, so total useful is 23 minus 1, which is 22. So 22 divided by 23 into 100. This is our CPU utilization. What is throughput? Throughput is total number of processes, which is 4 divided by total time. Okay, this is our throughput. I hope you understood this. If not, then please watch this question again. Now let's see, this is the question which arrived in GATE 2006 based on longest remaining time first scheduling algorithm. Remember that longest remaining time is always preemptive. Okay, so it cannot be non-preemptive. Longest remaining time. Okay, so now they are saying us the three processes of process ID 0, 1, 2, 3. So we are drawing the table first, because it is easy to visualize from table. So P0, P1, P2 with compute burst time as this. So burst time is 2, 4, 8. All processes arrive at time 0. That means arrival time is 0, 0, 0. Okay. And the algorithm we have to use is longest remaining time first, which we have already seen now only. And they have also told us in LRTF, ties are broken by giving priority to process with the lowest process ID. That's what we have studied now. And we have to find average turnaround time. Okay. Now, in order to find turnaround time, first we have to draw the Gantt chart. So let's draw it. at time 0 all are available. Okay, so which one is the highest? P2 is highest. See this. And we will not schedule till 8. Why? Because it is preemptive. When we will schedule till 4, it will become 4, and now these two processes are of same size, and they have already said that LRTF ties are broken by giving priority to process with lowest ID. So we have to schedule P1 now. Okay, so what students make mistake here, what they will do, they will schedule P2 till 8, and here the question will get wrong. So we will not do this. Now we will schedule P1 for how much time? For one time only. Why? Because after spending one burst time, it will no longer be the highest. The highest will be P2 now. So P2 till 1, because now if after spending one unit time, both have same time, so we have to schedule P1 again, and it will become 2. Again the highest one is this, so P2 till 1, and now this one and this one all have same time. So what we will do? We will take the lowest process ID. So this is P0. So P0 till one burst time only, because after spending one time, this will no longer be the highest. So highest or longest time is this one and this one. Tie will be broken by lowest ID. So we will choose P1 again for 1 second, and it will become 1. So taking P2 now, and this will become 1, and then 1 1 1, and then same order again, P0, P1 and P2, and this is not required to us, so this is extra. Now they have asked average turnaround time. So for average turnaround time, we need only completion time and turnaround time. So completion time will be taken from this side. We do not have to write start time here, because start time is used in response time. We do not have to write waiting time here, because it is not required. We will save time, but that is in exam. Here we can calculate all the things also. Okay, so please do it as a homework. I am calculating average turnaround time only. So from here, if we start, the completion time of P0 is 12. Completion time of P1 is 13. Completion time of P2 is 14. Okay. What is turnaround time? So turnaround time is CT minus arrival time. Arrival time is 0. So it will become 12, 13, 14 only. So average turnaround time will be 12 plus 13 plus 14. Divided by total number of processes, which is 3. So it comes around 39 divided by 3, which is 13 units. And you can see answer is A, 13 units. Okay. Thank you.